Hello everyone, Coach Andy here with Runners Connect. On today's Coach Chat, we will be talking about the rate of improvement and what we should expect. You know, if we've got a big goal coming up or we have a big goal that's been kind of looming out there, when should we be expecting to maybe go after those types of goals? So we'll chat about all those different things. We'll kind of go over the different parts and pieces that are connected to, you know, getting faster, what things we need to be thinking about improving, because really this concept is actually fairly broad. So there's no one thing that's going to make you faster. There's no one thing that's going to point to your progression is going to be X. Really hard for us to really know for certain what this is going to be. The answer, and like I said in the post for this one, is it kind of depends. So we'll go through some of the different things that we're going to factor into helping us to like make these decisions, really know what to expect, all of that good stuff. So starting out though, I wanted to share the question that we got from one of the other Runners Connect members, you know, that brought this conversation forward. And so I'm going to quickly read through what he mentioned and go through what his specific scenario is, and then we'll kind of dive into a little bit about his specific scenario and then go through kind of what kind of things we can be thinking and what the kind of things to expect. Some of you may find yourself very similar to his scenario, and so I think this will be super helpful. But let's go ahead and we'll hop into it here. So to read and to start off here, this is what the user sent to us. So as a new runner, 64 weeks and counting, how do you know what rate of progress to expect after the initial surge? So a lot of times, you know, when you first start training, you're gonna have a lot quicker rate of improvement. And so we see that with a lot of people, like they're not really sure where their fitness is going to be. Building fitness happens fairly quickly. We see kind of some progress made and then a big leap in that training, and the times are just coming down. We see this really sharp curve, but we also seem to find that everybody reaches a certain point where we start to level off a little bit. Not that we're going to plateau, but that we're going to start slowing down, or we're not gonna be seeing such major gaps in how much that we're improving season to season. So maybe you PR'd by, maybe you ran your first marathon and it was a kind of just we're going about it of let me try to finish, and then you are preparing for your second and you've got maybe a little bit more specific training kind of locked down. Maybe you're following a training plan, maybe you signed up for Runners Connect, and bam, you see this 20 minute PR or something crazy like that. Will we continue to see those 20 minute PRs? Most likely we won't continue to see that large of a PR. We may kind of start to see ourselves, you know, a 5 minute PR the next time, maybe 10 minutes, and then it kind of will start to trickle off. So if you think about what that curve is going to look like, it's going to go like this, and then it's going to start to go like this. And then we kind of just have to figure out like, where are we? What things can be impacting us? What things do we need to really nail down? And that's where that improvement curve is going to come from. But let me go ahead and finish reading through his question. So one of my long-term targets, which is when people start laughing or saying, yeah, right, is to run sub 20 minutes 5K by the time I am 75. I have 29 minutes to go, and having just done 23:55, not a clue whether sub 20 is a realistic at that age, but I have money riding on it. I have lots of longer distance targets, but this is the one that people seem to find the funniest. To me, it's just training in plus time to absorb it equals results. Am I being unrealistic and overconfident? So let's dive into this here a little bit. So one thing that we do know about running and as we age is that one of the first things to go is that speed is a little bit harder for us to kind of reach a certain level. That's what starts to fall off a little bit quicker, and that has a lot to do with actual muscle. We lose muscle as we get a little bit older. So one thing that's going to factor in here specifically is as this user gets older, he's going to need to make sure that he is really doing a good job of getting that strength work in. So that's where, you know, as we get older, we do need that balance of strength work and of the training. So we don't want to necessarily start to push the volume up or do anything too crazy on that front, because really we need to have a good balance of, you know, musculature and strength there in order for us to continue to see some of that power output. Because, you know, as we get longer in distance, it's that power output that we need. We also want to make sure we're protecting the muscles from injury, stuff like that. So we're more susceptible to a little bit more injury in different ways as we get older. So we really have to be mindful about, you know, all the injury prevention stuff and the strength training being really, really well done and really well designed, and actually paying a good bit of attention to that, not just the running. So, you know, it's not quite just training in and then time to absorb it. That is a piece of that. But there is also going to be, you know, the factor of how we go about this. So let me go ahead and share an article I've got loaded up here for you guys, because it's going to get a little bit more in depth on kind of kind of what we want to share here. So this is an article from Running Magazine. I think it's from Canada is from where the article is from. But anyway, so how long does it take to see results? When you start a new training program, whether you're beginning a new running plan for health reasons, adding strength training into your current regimen, to build muscle or increasing your mileage in hopes of lowering your PB, it takes time to see progress. But exactly how long does that process take? The answer to that depends on what type of improvements you're looking for, but regardless, it will take time and patience. So things that we're going to need to kind of really consider here: heart rate and blood pressure. As you get fitter, your heart gets stronger, which allows it to pump more blood with every beat. This in turn leads to a reduction in your resting heart rate. So we're gonna see some stuff that's happening a little bit more internally when we start to build up our, you know, start to run more, do more cardiovascular fitness type stuff. That's one thing that we're looking at. Then we've got the aerobic fitness that comes into play. So when it comes to speed and endurance, your rate of improvement will depend on your current fitness level. If you're just starting a new running routine and were previously inactive, you can see improvements in your cardiorespiratory fitness within 4 to 6 weeks. If you've been running for a while and you're trying to get faster, it may be a few months before you see any noticeable gains. So, you know, when we're starting out, or, you know, even for me, I took a 3-month break at the end of 2020 after also having some injury issues through 2020. So a lot of that year was actually fairly down for me, not a lot of training through that entire year. So coming back from that, and especially 3 months of like very inactive period for me, which was, you know, was a lot less than I'd ever done in my entire life, that coming off of that period, the, you know, the strength and the gains that I saw in improvement in performance, it did happen over the course of a year. It took a bit, but I was actually seeing a little bit more of that in progression just in those first few weeks. Now, as I moved into, you know, this last year, the progression slowed down a little bit. There was still some strength that I was gaining. I was seeing the times coming down. I was seeing things being a little bit easier than last year, but not as in a large of a leap as it was before. So that's something to consider, you know, over the course of the last year for me. My first 5K I did coming back from this break period was an 18:30. And then this year I ran a 17 something low. So even in that scenario, that's a minute and a half or so, but I've also been starting from a period of training where I'm fairly well trained. I just had to take some time off, and it wasn't like it was a ton of time off. So when we look at it that way, you know, I hadn't completely detrained. I hadn't lost all my fitness. I had just, you know, I'd lost a significant amount, but not enough that I was, you know, starting back from scratch or something like that. It might've felt that way, but just, you know, looking at that, like that's actually also coming from a well-trained perspective. So if you're really starting out new, we're going to see that window of time that you're going to see that improvement be fairly large. So as you get fitter, those improvements will happen in smaller and smaller increments as well. When you first start running, you may be aiming to knock minutes off your times. And as you continue in the sport, those minutes will become will often become seconds. So muscle and strength gains. So if you're looking for more immediate gratification, the gym is the place to go. According to some research, it's possible to see muscle gains after just a single session of strength training. This is due to a phenomenon known as muscle pump, which is just an increase in blood flow to your muscles. And while it's only temporary, it does make you feel like you've accomplished something when you leave the weight room. To see actual sustained muscle and strength gains, beginners should expect to wait roughly 6 to 8 weeks, while more experienced weightlifters may take upwards of 12 weeks after starting a new program. It's important to note, however, that muscle growth is highly variable depending on the individual. Sometimes tend to put on muscle more quickly than others. So if you don't see any gains right away, have patience. So, you know, even in this conversation, there's another factor that we're looking at here is, you know, with muscle and strength and stuff like that, when it comes to even just the training that you're doing, you have to have a really good balance of your fueling when you're putting all this stuff in. So you could do all the work, you could do all the training, you could go hard as can be, but if you're not fueling appropriately around your training, then we're more likely to see injury, we're more likely to see, you know, other issues arise. So, you know, oftentimes as a coach, I actually would rather see clients make smaller incremental gains in their fitness as opposed to like really, really large leaps, because sometimes that can be too much for your body at once and it doesn't end up being sustainable. Now, for people who are, again, like if you're starting out and you're in a place where you just haven't really done all the things yet to really seek out that potential, large gains aren't going to be problematic. It's really more when we get into like a really diving deep into the training, we've already kind of reached that point where now we're trying to, you know, assess what more can I reach, that we really don't want to get ahead of ourselves too much. If you've been training consistently for, you know, several years now and have seen little itty bitty gains like as you've gone along, then let's keep on that track. Let's see what other other things we can improve within that. So what does that look like? Maybe we improve your fueling. Maybe we improve your strength training. Maybe we incorporate maybe a little bit more different types of strength training. Maybe we, you know, alter a little bit of how we're training for things. So if you've been marathon training a lot, maybe we do a 5K or do something like that in the shorter distance just to work a different muscle group and then go back to that distance. Maybe we need to work on the mental game. So there's all these things that are included in within this whole, like, what does it look like to improve? So just to keep those things in mind as we go. So mental health, the great news is while physical changes are a little slower to appear, you can experience the mental health benefits of regular exercise almost instantly by starting out. So those are just a few other things that I just wanted to make sure I just wanted to go through. This is just a general list of some things that we're looking at in terms of, like, how do we know? How much faster will I get? This one also shows that if your blood pressure is already within a healthy range, you likely won't see any significant reductions when you start a regular exercise routine. This is really just talking about some of the heart rate type stuff. So we do want to kind of keep those things in mind, but we don't want to kind of be fixated on them. So now we're going to move over. I've got this race time improvement calculator that I found. This is going to be just beneficial for looking at kind of what the percentage will look like. What are we looking at in terms of, how much improvement that we need to make what's the percentage there? So let's go ahead and put in the example that we've got here. So what we've got is, let me see, how do I use this? 0 here. And then we've got, 2355. Okay, so looking at this here, in order to break 20% or 20 minutes, we would have to see a more than a 10%, increase in fitness just from where we are starting now. And so that's just like something to keep in mind when we think about, what are we looking at here? And so let's go into here a little bit more. So let me see, keep running in, blah, 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 blah. There is some stuff down here that I wanted to go over. So proof results this way. So math behind running. So target time improvement equals 5%. So the new time would be to improve time by 95%, blah, 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 blah. There's just some instructions here. I wanted to skip through this. So run by step with our calculator, harder, longer, faster, improve race time. So the longer you run, the more you train, the more difficult it is to cut minutes off your time. Probably you know that observation very well. Sometimes using a percentage to plan running improvements is much more practical. Highly trained athletes should expect improvements in the 2-4% range, while newbie runners can look for slightly better rates of initial enhancements. So I was reading somewhere, and I can't remember where I saw this. I was looking for it before we hopped on. But for the most part, right, we are looking at kind of that, the way that we see this improvement and the way that we kind of are interpreting all of this different stuff. And so athletes that are in the highly trained, they're going to be looking at those 2-4% range improvement maybe over the course of an entire year. Whereas, some of this improvement, we may be still maybe improving a little bit higher rate, but we're also looking at still over the course of a year, over the course of a season, we'll see some of these marked improvements. And then we'll hit a point where we're like, okay, now it's going to be all the nitty gritty stuff that we have to look for. So really high trained athletes are probably more on this 2% range in a single season. You're not seeing these huge jumps. Oftentimes the way that the training or recovery cycle is going to work is that you're going to, even from the start of a season, let me flip back to my regular screen here. Even from the start of a season, we are seeing ourselves, improving. We'll peak out a little bit. We'll go down just a tiny bit as we taper for the race. We'll race, hit that new PR. And then after the race, we actually want to see a little bit of detraining. So we dip back down below. So at the start of a season, part of our rate of improvement is actually getting that fitness back in and then allowing ourselves to get even higher in that next block. So again, if that's the case, if we're in that bucket, if we've been training consistently, start to think about, how have you improved over each season? Have you been seeing some consistent increase? And how has that been feeling? We don't want to get you into a cycle of overtraining just because we're chasing a goal that's like really just maybe a little bit ahead of us. So what I like to do is kind of think about, let's focus on, for this next 29 months here, let's look at, what can we do in the next 6 months? Maybe we look at dropping that 233 down to a low 23 or maybe sub 23. And then, the next 6 months coming off that, maybe we look at, improving that a little bit more. But, part of this is going to be kind of, how are we training? How are we keeping some consistency? So one of the biggest things and one of the biggest pieces to seeing improvement involves involves our consistency. So if we aren't able to train consistently, then we're going to have a hard time seeing any improvements at all. So that's where we ride that fine line of training, of not overdoing it. So when we overdo training, we are more likely to get injured, more likely to overtrain and be too fatigued to really even, show up to race day feeling good. And a lot of times then we have to plan an extra recovery time. We have to go through the injury recovery cycle. And so that curve that I was showing you that we want to do this, oftentimes it's going to end up having to do this. And then we kind of just stay stagnant a little bit. So that's why I typically want to encourage that we're not looking at, running 20 minutes too soon. Look at your curve and kind of look and see kind of like how you should from here. So like say if you're first, so you've been training for 64 weeks, which is a little over a year. So let's say we look at what was your first 5K time. Then let's look at what was your second 5K time and kind of look at some of your race times. And you can look at it from all the different distances and start to see if there's any correlation and about how much time you gained in each of those. And also look at some of the more recent variables. So how have you recently been increasing? How recently have you been getting a little bit faster? And were there any little things in the middle there that caused you to either have to pause training or change what you were doing or injuries or any of those things that have gotten in the mix that could be changing the way this looks? I think this is one of those things that can actually be almost scientific a little bit where, running is a lot of numbers, a lot of this stuff. And so, I come from a civil engineering background, so maybe this is a little bit from the way that I like to think about it, but, start to chart that out, see if you can see any patterns, and that'll give us a better estimate of when should we be thinking about going for these PRs. And I also like to think on the front of monitoring and tracking our progress, I think can also be really valuable for enjoying the process. And we have to enjoy the process. We have to believe in ourselves. All of these things have to come with, going for PRs, looking for improvement, stuff like that. So, I used to keep a training journal that was helpful for being able to just reflect and understand and recognize, where I've made mistakes in training so I can correct those in the next cycle. So, even for me right now, I was supposed to run a marathon, ran into some issues here at the end, what can we change from that so that I can, build on this fitness that I just built up but didn't get to race from? And what can I do to improve that in the future? How can I build upon that? And what's a realistic rate for me to look at, can I get a little bit faster? And some of this is just going to be monitoring the training, seeing what you're doing year to year, look back in your training log. If you log on Runners Connect, go back through, see what your last year was, see what times you were hitting then compared to right now, and help that be an assessment factor for, can I get faster? How much should I expect to get faster? And you can use your own data to kind of do that. That's a good reason for actually keeping a record or a log of the training you're doing and being able to see exactly how things have changed. Because, so much of this is also mental, like we said. So, if you have to believe that you can run these times, and I think it's great that this user has a goal that is so ambitious. I think that's great. I think it's important to have those goals out there just for being able to see yourself improve, being able to see yourself go after something that's challenging. I think it's good. I think it's really good to have these large goals, but don't let them dictate you. So, keep fighting and keep getting faster and keep focusing on what you can do to be better each day for yourself now and for the future. So when it comes to training, we really have to be a little bit future focused, because if we focus too much on the races of the present or what we've got going now, we oftentimes shortchange our future performance. And, especially if this goal is something that's big and maybe a little farther out, we really want to be thinking about what can I do now that's going to help me so that in the future I'm still working towards this goal and not, having injuries or stuff like that. So as big of a goal we might have, don't fixate on it so much that every season you have to do it. You have to do it, because it's going to make it a lot more challenging to enjoy it. And then to also feel like there is a possibility. Or, sometimes what happens too is if, this is what I experienced. I was trying to run a specific time so I could qualify for the marathon Olympic trials. And I was constantly trying to race and I wasn't listening enough to my body to help my body get back into a good rhythm of feeling good. And so I never saw any marked improvement. I actually was seeing a decrease in performance. I wasn't building upon these seasons before because I was rushing things and just kind of continually going after something that was definitely possible. But, you have to think about if this isn't working and this is something that I need to do, or if I need to rest or I need to do this, those are important things for also seeing that improvement. So listening to your body is huge when it comes to seeing that rate of improvement. So it's not just going to be, getting out there, running, doing all the things. It's also about staying balanced in everything that you're doing with rest, recovery, looking at your season as a whole, planning your training out. So there's so many factors that we want to actually stay on top of and not just kind of thinking about singular races, stuff like that. You know, this is also where some of that plan, you know, we've talked about in the past, some of that seasonal planning and how important that can be. So, you know, if you're starting out and you're going to figure out, you know, what are my goal races for this spring, map them out, set them up, set up a plan, and also think about where those natural recovery breaks need to be built in. I personally like to have 2 breaks a year. I am currently taking a 2-week break for this season, and then I will build back up for a spring marathon. So pay attention to where those are going to fit into your cycle naturally, because I think sometimes when we shortchange recovery in between cycles, that's where we actually see a lot of this stagnant training, where we aren't seeing ourselves get any faster. We need a little bit of the recovery and the training in order to actually see a lot of this take shape. So we need a little detraining. We need a little of these things kind of built into our programs. That's where a little of this is going to take a little bit more forward focus. I want to shift over because we did have some good questions also on the post in here that I wanted to make sure we can cover. So let me go ahead over here. So first question here, very interested in this one. Would love to set a goal to BQ, but not sure how many years to plan for a good benchmarks to set along the way. I can't break 2 hours on my half marathon time, so I know a BQ is way out of reach right now. So I like this question because she's bringing up the fact that she's having some struggles with breaking 2 hours in her half marathon. So I think this is, and the reason that I like this question, the way she phrased it, is that I think it's important to, you know, what can we do to also help us, give us some milestones that are shorter. You know, the half marathon is a great indicator of some of our marathon performance, our potential marathon performance, but it's also a race that we can do a few more, we can do a little bit more often, we have a little bit more feedback from that. Whereas, you know, like a marathon, you build up for a marathon, it's not going to be easy for us, you know, bounce back, do another marathon in a month. We can do that, but whether or not we're going to see a lot of improvement in that is just really dependent upon, you know, circumstance. So, you know, for the most part, you know, being able to do some more halves is going to give us a little bit more realistic idea of where we are fitness wise. We can do more of them. So if we end up with a bad weather race, our only indicators aren't just going to be from bad weather races. Maybe if we have one that's warm or humid or not great, and then we can enter one in a month to really see where our fitness is. That's a nice thing. A marathon, you can come out to race day and have, you know, something go wrong and it not even be a realistic look at your actual fitness. And so that can be the frustrating thing when it comes to marathoning. So I think it can be good to use, you know, something like a half marathon as a benchmarker, like start, you know, race a few of those and then, you know, do a marathon at the end of it, see where we come out, and then start using those as kind of indicators of where we are fitness wise. I don't know, Sarah, what your BQ time is, so I can't really say like what are we looking at in terms of how many years to go. Let me look and see if we've got, let me stop sharing my screen real quick. I'm gonna do a little of investigating here to see if we can find out what the BQ time we're looking at here is. So put back on my default screen real quick. I'm gonna hop into Sarah's profile and see if we can find, okay, so for that age group, let's see if we can find here. So Sarah is looking at a 3 hours and 35 minutes for a marathon time. So, you know, it depends, again, like it's so hard to say like exactly how long it's going to take somebody to see this improvement, you know, but I do think like consistent training and doing all the things that you can to really and really formulating a good race plan and a good strategy for, you know, long-term growth is the best way we can do this. I have a friend who ran, I think her first marathons were maybe in the 3:30s or something like that. And she just ran the 2024 Olympic trials standard with a 2:36:40 recently. So her last marathon before that, she ran a 2:37 something. Before that, it was like 2:39 or 2:40. So she was seeing very small incremental growth year to year, but she was seeing that and she was seeing consistent performance, you know, consistent training. She was seeing those things happening. So, you know, focus on those things first. Focus on the things that you can nail down. And you'll, so maybe that means, Sarah, that you focus on nailing down that sub 2 hour half marathon first. Marathon's a lot to put on your body. So if you feel more comfortable, you know, shooting for some half marathons for a bit and getting some speed, I think that can also be a really good way to work on our running economy. So that's one thing I haven't covered yet, is part of your improvement curve is also going to not just be your cardiovascular fitness, but also your running economy, different things that we need to work on. So biomechanical, how we move, are we running efficient? Are we doing things like that? Because that's going to play a huge factor in if we're able to see those improvements. We need to practice using good form. So maybe we need to do more form drills, things like that. So if you feel like you're having some some difficulty with any form related things, you know, do some shorter distance training for a bit of time, because that's also going to help us to actually work on the form more. So those are some things to consider if you're trying to think of some other ways that we can see some of this improvement, stuff like that. So moving back over here to our next question. So let me go back to sharing my screen here. So Shay asks, I have a question. Can I do my speed work on the treadmill when the weather is bad? It is beginning to snow in Michigan. I'd like to PR in my 10K by December. My goal is under an hour. So, you know, doing training on the treadmill is totally fine. I would say one thing that we typically recommend is to put the treadmill at, you know, 1% grade, you know, especially if you're doing just so that that's mostly just so that we're making sure we're utilizing the right muscle group. So putting the treadmill at a slight incline just helps us to recruit the glutes and everything in the same way that we would if we were running on flat ground. So that can be a good way to, you know, still do your speed work on the treadmill. And so that, you know, the speed work may be a little bit difficult on the treadmill, just, you know, some of those paces can feel super quick, so just be very careful with it. But I don't see why you wouldn't be able to do any of this stuff if you're able to go outside for anything at all, if things can get cleared or any of that stuff. I think that's great for just a couple of your runs, just to make sure that we have a good idea of what those paces feel like on you know, outside on like true conditions, because I think we're gonna need a little bit of that if we're able. But be very careful, we don't want you to get injured running outside in tough conditions. So Joseph asks, also interested in this one, coming back from a long hiatus, I am curious to see how close I can get to old PR times or maybe even surpass them. I personally have seen great progress, but it's also frustrating when comparing current self to past self. The biggest thing I'll say that to that, Joseph, is, you know, we've already talked through a lot of the things that are going to help us to assess if we're getting faster or not, or what our rate of improvement is going to be. But when it comes to comparing yourself to your past self, that I think can actually be very prohibitive to your improvement. So you can use those goals as, you can kind of put those out there. It's reframing in your brain how you think about those and make them more exciting to go after, as opposed to making them be something that makes you feel bad about what you're doing. Like I said, we have to kind of enjoy what we're doing. We have to be excited about it in order for us to see growth, improvement, and all of that stuff, because your brain has such a huge impact on your performance. So the way that I would say to really shift that for you, Joseph, would be to, you know, don't think about how much faster you used to be. Think about how close can I get to being as fast as I was at this age when I am this age. I think that that's a fun way to kind of look at it. It'd be like, I'm going to try to beat my 20-year-old self or something like that. So think about this person whose times were X and think about them as somebody else that are out there on the course and be like, you know what? I'm whatever age, you know, I'm 32 now. That's what I've been using as my fuel is I'm 32 now, but I'm going to run faster than I ever did in my 20s. That's kind of the way that I've fixated on my current goals, is to see if I can do that. It's not going to be the end of the world if I don't. That's not going to be the make or break, but it just kind of is exciting to see if I can do that. You know, prove to myself that I've got more in the tank than, you know, just because I'm older doesn't mean anything. So I would use that as a challenge and challenge yourself to think that way, and think also age is just a number and let me see what I can do. And at the very least, we covered this on a recent podcast. I'm talking about masters runners and how some of that, how can we run faster at 40 than we did when we were younger? And I think one of the ways that we can do that is just to be a better racer and outperform our younger selves, even if the times aren't any faster. So you can look at the age graded stuff. You can look at kind of to see kind of where you are age graded comparatively. I think that can be really valuable to kind of see that maybe you are outperforming the runner that you used to be. So I think that can be really cool to also motivate and stay focused on just improving from where you are now, because that's the best way to get faster is, you know, be where you are now and think about what you can do and move forward. So yeah, thank you guys for those great questions there. I know that this topic is super hard to really definitively give a great answer on. There's just so many variables, so many things to consider when it comes to the rate of improvement and what we're looking at. I think, you know, set yourself some big goals, and then each season some smaller, more incremental goals that are achievable. And that way we're constantly looking at, you know, something that's a little bit more short term, a little bit more, you know, that gives us a little space so that we're not fixated on the must run 20 minutes in our 5K. What about, you know, just looking at, okay, this next 5K I have on the calendar, let me see if I can drop 30 seconds off. You know, conservative goals I think are great because it helps us to be still moving forward, seeing our progress, not getting ahead of ourselves in terms of feeling like we need to do anything. I think it's a lot of, there's so much mental involved in this. And then beyond that, it's more of the, you know, what ancillary work are we doing? You know, are we staying consistent? consistent? Are we preventing injury? Are we doing things that we can from that front? Because all of those things impact our long-term, you know, performance gains. So that just about covers everything here. Anyone listening to this recording, if you have any questions, I know that I talked a lot, and there's a lot of little things all over the place here. So feel free to ask any questions in the post here in the stream, and we'll make sure that we get those covered. But you know, thanks for tuning in before me, and we'll cover some more of your questions and coming up and some future coach chats for things. So thank you guys for submitting some of those last week. If anyone listening didn't see the post from last week, I asked for any questions that you guys might want covered in a future coach chat. And so, you know, feel free to go add to that list, do whatever you want, so that we can make sure that we're constantly bringing you guys the questions that you have and answering anything that we can best we can. So anyway, hope you guys enjoy the rest of your Wednesday and the rest of your week, and I will see you all again next week. All right, bye everyone.